Still we are discussing algorithms, analysis of algorithms. So if you remember, we were somewhere here at the analysis of insertion sort. So if you remember there are two loops in this whole algorithm. One of the loop is for, we don't have any method to avoid this loop. This loop will be there. The second loop while will be executed if this condition is true. So if this condition is not true, then while loop will not execute. So that why always what will happen here, that there will be no execution of this part. So it will be actually only one loop's execution. So it will be a linear kind of algorithm. So that analysis is shown here. If you add up all of the items and then take it like this and make Tj, which is here, Tj is here in this place, Tj here. If we make this Tj 1, then this loop will not execute. So it means C6 and C7 will not execute because this part will be 0. So that will make it something like this, a linear structure, order of n order algorithm. So n times executions. So this is one of the, now if you see next slides, I added few more slides here. If Tj is equal to 1, then this is the situation. But if Tj is equal to j, means is the total number of execution is equal to the j loop, then it will be n square. In that case, it will be n square. Even if it is j by 2, still it will be n square. So in the case, in the worst case, it will be n square. In the average case, it will also be average case, because this is shown here from the algorithm that the Tj here, if I replace it with j, then it will be executing n times. So n into n, that will give us n square. Okay, so this is a further analysis, a little bit more about worst case and average case. An algorithm may run faster on certain data sets than others. This is very true. Sometimes, as we have seen here, if this loop does not execute here, then it means the data is what? Already in sorted form. So that is a different data as compared to unsorted form. Excuse me, please. Here we have this is the case, finding the average case can be very difficult. So typically algorithms are measured by worst case time complexity. So we need to know what is the worst case, because average case will be very difficult because we don't know about the data, what kind of data will come. If you gave me data from, suppose, a remote site, it could be any form, it could be sorted, it could be unsorted, and so on. So let's see the worst scenario, what is the worst situations. Excuse me, are you doing something else or what? Please listen, because this is very important. You have a question on this in your mini project, and there will be a question, couple of questions in the final exam, okay? Also, in certain application domains, knowing the worst case time complexity of a crucial importance. Okay, so here if you see the inputs, this is a graph which shows the best case will be somewhere lying here, then the worst case is here. In between them will be the average case. This is the total time taken. Sometime you get a data which gives you this much complexity, sometime you get a data it goes up to here, sometime it's here, and so on. These are different sets of data, A, B, C, and so on. Then this is, you have the time. So it varies, okay? It is not fixed. Until unless you make a fixed loops. Now you see the other algorithms, which is bubble sort. We discussed already and we have implemented it using lab activities time. And I also wrote an algorithm on the board. Now see the bubbling, the bubble sort algorithms, which bubbles up data, largest is taken to the right place, to the last location. Now here see a little bit of graphical representation here, that how the data will move. We have a data like this, 77, 42 and so on, that should be brought to which form here, to this form, 5, 12, 35, then I can say this is in ascending order. Now see the next slides, the data will be bubble the largest value to the end using pairwise comparison and swapping. So now if you I click here, suppose these two are compared, first two, and then what happens if the first one is larger than the second one, then they will swap. Otherwise there will be no swapping. Okay? Otherwise there will be no swapping. So what will happen? If suppose I put here instead of 42 I put 32 and then 42. Now here I'm comparing two elements, then what happens? This is so no swapping, then what I do? What will be my next? Next element. What I compare next time? What I compare now? Good. Third with the second. So whatever I have here, suppose here I have 27, now I will compare second with the third and see. If I go like this with the data, then what happens at the end? I will be just able to place one item in its right place. Only one item at its right place. And then I have to do the same thing for other elements. So if I have n elements, number of item n, then how many comparisons will I need to do? N into n, n square comparison. So here the comparison is done. Now you see here, they are swapped. Swapping is done here because here in this case 77 was greater than 42. Now second and third will compare. And here again swapping is done. Again there will be swapping. Okay, now there will be no swapping in this case, okay? No need to swap here in this case. And then now eventually there will be a swapping. So this way the algorithm actually works, but what we have done in one iteration, in one pass over the data, if I have 1 million items or 1 million iterations, after 1 million iterations what I will do? I will fix only one item. And what about 1 minus 1 million? I will need another minus 1 million operation to fix other elements. Now see next time what we will do, one largest value correctly placed. And which is very clear from this and also from our algorithms. This is the algorithm here. We have loops here. We have then swapping here. And this goes in. This is the procedure to change. Last time also I told you how we can do it. T is equal to A is equal to B, and so on. The auxiliary or temporary variable will be required. If this temporary variable is not there, we cannot do swapping. And then now notice that only the largest value, one largest value is correctly placed, all other values are still out of order. So we need to repeat this process. The process should be repeated. Now I will do that if we have n elements, if each time we bubble n elements, we place it in its correct location, then we repeat bubble ups. Process how many times? N minus 1 time. And that guarantees we will correctly place all elements, all n elements. Now here if you see in this diagram, first was we place what? 101, then 77 was brought here, then 42 was brought here, then 35 was brought here, and now finally what we brought? 12 was brought here. And 5 is it in its right place. We don't need that last iteration. So n minus 1. So the total number of iteration you see is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then how many inside iterations will be? That will be 6 iterations. So this is that why the algorithm takes n square time. Okay. Why you are that? You are stuck in some other class or what? Yeah. Canteen mein the. Well, we need to run this cafeteria as well, okay? There's another thing, they don't give anything to the Accra University, they're taking everything by keeping in their own pockets. So this is, I hope this will be very clear. For newcomers, we are discussing still, analysis of the algorithms, okay? So I showed them a couple of slides about Here, this was a new slide here, that how the worst case will be, how the average case in the case of insertion sort. Then a little bit the presentation of the data here, that if I have here seven sets of data, different sets of data, one may take 5 milliseconds or microseconds, another one takes might be 3, and so on. So it varies, you see, from data to data. You don't have that fixed number of iterations. Sometimes you have this much of iterations in the case of insertion sort, and so on. Because there is a one condition that is very important in the insertion sort is this one. While here, some people may be using here a for loop. If you are using a for loop, then it will be fixed. But if you are using here a while condition, then this condition, if this condition true, then it will go down to this loop. Otherwise, these two statements here, statement number 6 and 7, they are totally conditioned. And based on the condition here, they will execute. If they execute, first of all, whether they execute, and if they execute, how many times they will execute. So they will execute actually n times if they execute, both of them. So, but in many cases, they will not execute. So if they do not execute, that's why you see data like this. Sometime it is taking 5 microseconds, sometime it takes 3, sometime it takes 4, 5, and so on, varies from data to data. So here we have an average case, this is the best case. This is the best case here, the minimum. This is the minimum type of the algorithm. This is the minimum, and this, you see, I have given 6 examples, 6 sets of data. A is 1 set of data. I hope you understand sets of data means, if suppose I present 12, 15, 3, 100, 5, 10, something like this. This is one set of data. This is A. How much time it takes for insertion sort to sort this algorithm? In your analysis, in mini project, you have to do something like this. So this is one set. B is another set. Suppose now I present data something like this. 3, 8, 2, 1, 100, 101. So this is set number B. And then I have another set number C. So I first enter this data, then enter this data and this data. How much time taken by insertion sort, sorting A set, then B set, then C set. That is plotted in this bar chart. So this is the way how you analyze. When you write a program, you have already written program for bubble sort. You can write program for insertion sort, and then put different data and see how much time it takes, how many iterations, the counters I showed you last time. So that you can display in this form. When you display in this form, the minimum will be what the best case. But it is very difficult to rely on or base your conclusion on the best case. Because if you get, you see here, in 7 instances, in 7 sets of data, how many time it goes to best case only in one case. So in 2 cases, it goes to the worst case, totally worst case. One is best case, the other are average. So it's very difficult to calculate what the best case and average case, because it depends on the data. So the best will be what you calculate the worst case of the algorithm and make your decision either to select an algorithm or reject an algorithm based on the worst analysis. So if the worst is high, then it means the algorithm is very dangerous. If the worst is controllable or low, then you can say that is the best algorithm to choose. So then we start discussion on the bubble sort. This was already discussed in the last class in the so we were somewhere here that this that takes n minus 1 iteration to sort, and then n number iteration within the data. Now see what happens if suppose I have sorted data, totally sorted data in this algorithm. How much time it will take using this algorithm? A normal algorithm which we have written in the lab. We wrote like this, if you remember, that there were 2 loops, I loops, and there were J loops as well. So what is the situation? What will be the situation if I get already a sorted data? Suppose I get a data like this, that 1, 2, 3, 8, 10, and then 50 suppose. Then what happens in this case? How many time it will take? If I'm using the same algorithm. Same, how much time? N is here. N means is the total number of data, N is here. How many time here the body of the program will execute? N times or a little bit more than N times? Sorry? No, but did you put any check? Is there any condition? There's no condition. If I put some kind of condition here, if I change my algorithms and then incorporate some kind of condition here, that if there is no swapping in the first pass, what happens here? If suppose this is the situation, if I have this data, I hope you understand what I'm trying to say here is the, if my data is like this, This is here, the data, original data was like this. In the first pass, we took 101 here. The swapping was done, okay? Again, there was swapping. What happens if I get a data like this? 1, 2, 3, 4. Still this passes will be done. I'm sure still this passes will be done, okay? This will not be done. What will happen? How I can stop that? The data is already in sorted form. Don't go. Just stop. Yeah. So what? How I can do this? This is again. Let me bring this here to the original form. This was the original form. Okay. You see, first iteration. This is first. We are still in the first iteration. There is a swapping here. There's a swapping here, there's again swap here, no, and here is swap. If this data is like that, 1, 2, 3, 8, 10, 50, then what will happen? Every time it will say, no swapping, no need to swap. And if I get this message in all of the situation, which I will get in that case, then do I need to do another iteration on the data? I do not do another iteration. I do not need to do another iteration. So I can put a condition if there is no swapping in the one pass, one complete pass, there is no iteration, no swapping, then I say the data is already in sorted form. So I don't need to run for other iterations. You see that I can avoid, I can do, this is one pass. After one pass, what happens? I got data like this. 101 is now placed at its right position. This is what happens. I need to do another because the remaining data here, you see, 42, 35, 12, 77, 5, they are not in the right positions. I need to run the algorithms again, which is discussed here. This will be repeated like this. This was first pass, then second here. Okay. 77 is placed in the right place, it was here, it was brought here, then 45, 42 was here, it was brought here, and then next pass, 35 has brought here, then 12 has brought here. So, if the data is already sorted, then here, from here onward, up to here, I do not need any iteration. Okay, I do not need those iterations, because the data is already sorted, but the only thing what I need to do, I need to put a condition here. If there is no swapping while going through the whole data, then do not do further iteration, just stop. And that can be done. See now next slides, the discussions. Now here, this shows very clearly, this we have an inner loop and we have outer loop. There are two loops. And what happens if this is the situation? Already sorted collections. So what if the collection is already sorted? What happens here? What if only a few elements were out of place and after a couple of bubbles up the collection was sorted? Then what happens in this case? We want to be able to detect this situation, and then what to do? Stop early. So, like in this situation here, we can use a Boolean variables. I can use a Boolean variable, conditional variable. I hope you know what is Boolean. If no swapping occurred, then we say the data is already sorted. This Boolean, whatever we call it, flag or what, needs to be reset after each bubble ups. So I can put a condition here, like here, data swap true. This is a new condition here. I have two loops, one loop, another loop, and now I put a condition here. A condition here, a condition here. If suppose something true here, it means no swapping was done. So when no swapping was done, it means the data is already in sorted form. So I just need to run once this loops. This loops will run one time. Sorry. So now here, this situation. Now see here in this graphical representation again. What happens here? In the first case, there will be what? 98. There will be swap, okay? So the swap is done, okay? And that is now, see, new data. We have 23 and then 98. Then what happens next time? Yeah, there will be still. Good. Then again. So now this Boolean operator will be telling us there was swapping. So we cannot stop after first iteration because there was swapping, many swapping. It's not only one. So this is done. Now what happens? First bubble is first finish. Now see, it will go up to fourth or something like this. Now second one, no swapping, but there is a swap. So in the second pass also we got Boolean condition that is not true. Okay. Then we have got here swap, here no swap, swap here, and no swap here. Okay. And we reached what? Before this, if you see, we finished with the second, okay? Now 67, 98. Okay, now third one, this swap, okay, no, and there will be no further swaps anyway, because the rest are third finished. Now see fourth, and onward now what will happen after the fourth? Now what about the data? Is already sorted, but we still, if we go n minus 1, then we need to do two other passes will be done. So now you see here, it tells us now, see, first no swap, and up to here there was no swap anyway, the data was sorted that stage. Now here it will stop at this stage. So we did not do any swapping, so all of the other elements must be correctly placed. It means if there was no swapping, so we can skip the last two passes of the outer loops. We can skip the other. We don't need to now run over the data. If I make fixed loops like this, then it will be fixed. I cannot do anything. It's going from 1 to n and 1 to n. That will be done because there's no condition. If I put condition in between, if there was no swapping, there was no interchange, then what we do, we need to stop. So only one extra statement will be required. Just one statement will be required, one operation, one instruction will be required to check for me. And here in this case, you see that how many iterations were done? Two less than the original. So this is the bubble sort algorithms. The maximum is n minus one time. We can finish earlier if no swapping occurs. We can finish it earlier in the case of bubble sort as well. So this is the case. Any question up to here? I hope you will incorporate this kind of thing to you all. Question number 3 or whatever was in the mini project. Okay, so in the lab's next lecture, which is on Thursday, we will sit again together and see how we can incorporate all of these discussion and see what is the total time taken by bubble sorts in normal situation. When I put a condition there, that if there is no swapping, then how we can control. So this is known as optimization. Now what we are doing, we are optimizing our algorithms. We are not changing anything, we are not bringing a new algorithms, but what we do in this case, we put into something into the algorithms, and that make it sometime, if there is no need to do something, it will stop. Okay. And the example is here. So you go through these slides, this is very useful. Now we go to another categories, algorithms. And this is a very, very useful algorithm, quicksort. I have a very good discussion on this. But before this, if you have any question in the previous, any question, anything, the silence shows that, what it shows, I don't know. You are maybe so happy because this is last lecture, so we can, at least you can finish with me, at least. But we have still three labs, inshallah, three, four labs, okay, remaining. Now you see here quicksort. This is, as the name shows, the quicksort is a fastest algorithm. We can call it a divide and conquer as well. Why not what we do, if we get data like this, why not divide it into two parts and deal with each part at a time? So it will be quicker. Normally it will be quicker. And if I get this data, if I sort it into two halves like this, 12, 15 and 3, maybe one of them is sorted. One of the part is already sorted. So I don't need to run something. So divide and conquer, that is another concept. Always you will see in the books on algorithms and data structure that you divide the problems into sub-pieces and then provide a solution to each piece. And that all solution at then should be combined. That there will be some overhead cost. If you divide data, that will need some money. You divide the data and then you provide solution to each one and then combine all those solutions to one. That will of course need some extra overhead. That is known as overhead cost. So the overhead cost must not be very high. You see parallel algorithms, parallel computation, you might know about the parallel computations. How the parallel computation is done, that any problem you give to a single machine, that can be solved by what? By many machines, if they are installed in a parallel fashion. But then you need to divide your problem, and then each parallel machine should get a piece of the problem and solve it and then provide you a combined solution. So that division and then combining the results will also need some extra computational cost. So one of the algorithms is quicksort, which does more of the same thing. What it does, it takes one of the elements known as pivot element. Pivot is V, we call it V in A. A is what? An array. Within A, it takes one of the elements, call it pivot, and then partition A, the data, into something like this. You see this mathematical, small mathematical equation, that one part is A1, another part is what? A2. So my data is here, something like this. This is one part, I can call it what? A1. And I can call this part as A2. One of this element remaining, I can call it what? Pivot V. That is known as V. Pivot is terminology used for this. And all of the elements within the A part, let me give you another example. I have an example here. So let's see, we go here. A1 is here, what? That X belongs to X. And what is here? X belongs to A. And what is going here? That X is what? Less than or equal what? The pivot, V, which is we have selected. And A2 is what? Same thing, but here X is what? X is greater than or less than V. So if you take example, one is there, I can show you that, and let me make another one. Here, if I have a data like this, suppose I have elements like this, 10, 20, 2, 11, 15, 3, 5, maybe somewhere here. One of the elements I can take is a pivot. Suppose I take 11 is a pivot. So 11 is V, that is as a pivot. And I put X A1, which is what all of the elements less than 11. So what are less than 11? 5, 2, 3 and 10. So it means A1, that is equivalent to what? 4 elements, out of those whatever, 5, 6 elements, and all of them are less than V. And then the remaining part is what? A2, and that is what? 15, and then 20. So 2 elements are remaining. So A is equal to what? 2 elements, A2. So I have two arrays. One was A was divided into two based on what principle? Based on this principle that we have selected one elements, and all of the elements less or equal to that is in one part, and all of the elements greater than equal to that, greater, is their place in the second part. So I actually created two arrays. Now you see that one of the elements is in between, that has been fixed. At least one of the elements has been placed in its right place. That is in between, in the right place. All those elements are below and those elements are greater. Then what I can do? I do the same thing here. If I do the same thing here, the same here. I select a pivot here and then I select a pivot here as well. So next time when I go, how many other elements will be sorted? Two other elements will be sorted. Suppose here I choose 3. 3 is in one side. This is a pivot here. What will go to this side? Only 2 will left this side. Then 5 and 10 will go this side. And here it is one, only 2 elements. So that will be already placed anyway. If I select 15, 20 will go to the other side. Now here what is the situation? First iteration I have sorted how many elements? 1 elements. In the second iteration I have sorted how many elements? 2 elements, 3, 15 and 10 was, 11 was already sorted. So in total now how many elements were sorted? 3. If I go further down, now how many parts I have of the data? This is A11 here, this is A12, this is, there's nothing here, and this is A2, this is A22. A21 is here. There's nothing in A21 and the remaining is, so I have divided A to two parts, then those two parts to how many parts? 4 parts. 4 will be divided to 8 parts, 8 will be divided to what? 16 and so on. And in each part I will be increasing the number of data that will be sorted. So this will be the best way they divide the data. Now see here an example, another example. Here, if I have a data like this, this is my data here. I can choose a pivot. Suppose I have chosen what? 65 out of this data. Then how it will be done? I hope you see it properly. There's all elements greater than 65 are here, which is 92, 75, 81, and remaining which is below, which is less than what? Less than 65, they are here. So the data has been divided into how many partition? 2 partition, total 3. And this one is sorted, if you see. This is by default, this is sorted, because that is going to be in the right place. All elements below that one and greater than. Now here the discussion, if you see, since the partition steps, that is ambiguous, describe what to do with elements equal to the pivot. One thing maybe you will be a little bit worried about, if I have another 65, where it will go? That is one thing. It can go to either side, depending on the designers, depending on your solution, that you want to put 65 here or here. Both are acceptable. Equal here or equal the other side, okay? Part of good implementation is handling this case as efficiently as possible. Ideally, half of the element go to A1, another half goes to A2. But this is not true in this case. If you see how many elements went to first element here, first part 6 elements here, and how many? Only 3 here. So this division is not a very good division. If you see, this is a little bit, we are going to be in the worst kind of situation, because we get higher part on the one side here, the data is not equally divided. If we were chosen 43, then what would happen? If we would choose 43, then what would happen? 65, 31 and 57 would be here. And 13, 26, 0, 31, 4 would be here, 6 would be here. Okay. The best choice in this will be what? Maybe 57. If we take 57, then what happens? 57, then 65, 92, 4 will go to one side and 5 will go to, I think, the other side. Something like this. So which will be the best? But how we can do this? What do you think? Pivot, now pivot is very important. There might be a situation, I take pivot 0 in this data, what happens? If I take 0 as pivot. Well, what happens if I take 0? It is a random selection, suppose. Then how many elements can go to one side? Sorry? Yeah, okay. So 0 will be one side, which is pivot here, and then the remaining is here, which is more or less similar, like n minus 1. N minus 1 will go here, okay? So even if I divide this further, okay, let's see next. After this, if I choose, suppose, 2013, then what happens? Next pivot, if I choose here, I cannot do it one item. So that is sorted. Nothing here on the lesser side. Everything is greater than 0. Suppose next is 13. Pivot is 13. Then what will happen? All element, it means n minus 2 will go here. And what is left here? The 0 left here. Then next, suppose select is 26. Then again, is n minus 3 here and nothing here. So if I go like this, selecting 0 first as a pivot, then 13, then 26, this will give me worst situation. This will be worst situation, and there's a possibility if I'm taking randomly or if I'm leaving it to the users. So I need to do some techniques with this. The pivot must be what? Somewhere the middle of the data. So how you can choose the middle of the data? We'll need an extra work, okay? If you want to get more marks, then you do more work, okay? If you gave me your project, mini projects, my name is written in golden words, then I gave you extra marks, okay? But if you write my name is very small, I cannot see it with my naked eyes, I can punish you even. Huh? So the extra work you will get extra. Here is, I need to do some extra work so to avoid that worst situation, which can be avoided. The worst situation can be avoided. If you see, the worst situation is not very big problem. The only thing I need to choose what? A pivot which is somewhat in the middle of the data. So what should be the result? Find maybe largest number, some people might be saying. Largest and smallest. Sorry? Yeah, we can calculate the average and then take a number which is close to the average, maybe something like this. Okay. Or why not take three pivot instead of one? Because taking average will take how much time? You know, that we need to.
On every step.
Okay, so why not I take three random selected items? Three, like one I take 81, another I take 31, another comes 0 even. And I calculate the median of these three. If I take the median, that will be either 31 or something. 31 will be the middle. So it will be not 0, not 81 or 82. Okay. So and that will be easy because it was just selecting how many items? Three items. So it's not n times. If I'm taking average, then of course I have to run over the data how many times? N times. Minimum n times to calculate the average. And then the summation, then division will come there. And then choosing average and then calculating, comparing it with all the elements again. So who is the closest, that will be chosen. But that is one possibility. Now here, choices of pivot is what? Popular uniform choices to use the first element as the pivot. I can choose the first element as pivot. Okay, and this will work if the data is what? Random. I can take first, but if the it goes to recursion then, okay? First I get the data here, A, that is divided into two parts, then those two parts will be divided to what? Four parts and so on. So this will go up to what? Finally I reach either to one element left or two elements left. So I'll go up to n minus 1. So in the case of n minus 1, then I stop. So there's a stopping condition. Where we stop, remember that recursions, that each time when we go to next step, the data is reduced by one. The solution is going closer to the major solutions, and then the data is divided into. So that is a, and that will give us a, in a good situation, it will be something like this. It might be. Okay, the light goes again, so let me finish before that. This is a bit shameful situation for us because we have not able to solve this problem. Okay, this is, you are somewhere here, that pivot is, if the data is pre-sorted in reverse order, then the choice of pivot provides poor partitions. That will be another way to choose the pivot randomly. This is, this strategy is generally perfectly safe, but subject to the random generation flaws, median of three partitions. We can do the best choice of pivot would be the median of the array. It makes the whole process of quick sort slow, because then good choice would be to choose three numbers and then use median of these three as pivot. If I take the median of the whole array, then it here you see the discussion here that this quick sort will be slow because I have to go through the whole data for the medians. Instead of that, what I do, I take three numbers and take the median of the three numbers. So that would be, most probably that will be a good choice. Now, there will, we have worst situations, then we have an average case running situation. Now, if you see on the next, this is a quick sort, this is a general abstract implementation pseudocode. The situation will be something like this. We take A, this is the total data, then we have two indices, which P and R. I can make partition like this, A, P and Q minus 1, and then Q plus 1 up to R. So the total data goes what? From P to what? R. I can say from P to Q minus 1, that is the middle, and then from Q plus 1 to what? R, which is the last element. So we can do partition like this. I hope you understand this. If you can make this kind of recursions, this will do the partition. The partition is done like this. Suppose the middle is Q, the middle is Q of the data. The starting is P. P is the starting point here. And R is the maximum, the last one. And in the middle I have Q here. Suppose this is the middle. So what I do, I want to put this data in one part, which is A, 2, and here this will go to what? A1. So this will be what? P2 Q minus 1, and this will be what? Q plus 1 to what? R. So this is another. So what is in the middle? What is left? One item is left. That is Q. So Q plus 1 to last element, and first element to what? Q minus 1. That will make the partition. One part and then another part. This will be the routines which do the sorting here. The sorting, the whole sorting is done like this if you have recursion. If you don't have recursion, then of course it will take longer time. It will go something like this, that the data is divided into two parts. P will be where, R will be where, and so on. If you see, this is an important slide now. What happens in the worst situation? Worst situation will be like this. That if I make partitions, in one partition I get one item, like the, before I was showing you zero, okay, first item, and then the remaining will be what? N minus 1. And then the second partition, again I get the same situation. N minus 1 is now divided into two parts, and one is here, and then how many will go here? N minus 2. N minus 2 is again divided into 2. I get one item here, and N minus 2, and so on. Now here the situation will be what? That the whole partition I am doing 1, 2, this will go up to how many partition? N partitions. And each partition take how many iterations? N iterations. So in total it will give me N square. This will be the worst situation. Maximum possible worst situation, maximum possible time for quick sort will be if the partition is like this. That one part is taking one item and the remaining goes to the second part. And the same thing continue. If I am so unlucky that each time what I do, I get a partition, a favorite number, which gives me N minus one data on one side, one data, only one item on the other side. Then it will make something like this graph you see on the screen right now. It gives something like this. And since we have N number of data, this will go N, and here each one will run N, so that will make us how much? N square. The total time will take will be N square. Now another situation you see. This will be the best case here. First time I divide data into two, and it goes N divided into two, so one half, exactly half data goes here, half here. Suppose I have 11 elements, 5 of them goes here, and 5 of them go here. So in total I have 2 partition equally partition. Then next time I have something like this, again I am lucky here. This is divided into 2, so this will go N by 4, N by 4 here and so on, and similarly here. This will give me the total time will be even less than the total number of data. You see, one is N, another is log N. Log N means is the further reduced actually. N is reduced by something. So now, if the data is divided like this, in the first part what I am doing, I am sorting 2 elements, then in the second iteration I am sorting 4 elements, then 8 elements, then it will be 16, and then it will be 32 and so on. In that case, it will take even less time than N. Okay? The total time will be less than, quite less than N. But I will need N times on the data, because the data will be scanned N times. So that's why it you see N log N. It is not N square. It is not N multiplied with N. It is not N multiplied with 2N or N by 2. This is log, because each time I am reducing the data. The size of the data is reduced dramatically or drastically. You see, at first it was reduced to 2, then 4, and then so on. If you reverse it, then it gave you how many each. Finally, eventually you get one item in each partition. So this shows the best case. If I'm lucky and I'm getting each time what kind of partition which equal divide the data, or near to equal maybe. We will not get something like this every time it will be 11 data. If I have 11 items, then it will go to 10, each side will have 5, then 5 will go to, will not go to 2.5 but 3 and 2 and that way. So, but if it is almost equally partitioned, then I get a situation like this, in which situation it take almost N, because log N will give very small value. It will be not equal to N, not equal N by 2, N by 4, but very, very small value. So these are the two situations. Here is the worst situation, and here we have got the best situation. And the worst is also the average. This could be average situation as well. So we don't have any average case in this data. But we can say, okay, sometime maybe there's we get a good division here. So we can say that is an average case. But the worst situation even, that is controllable in the case of quick sort. So if you write an algorithm, write this algorithm, convert it to program here, this one, and bubble sort, and insertion sort. Now you have 3 algorithms. If you compare 3 of them, using the passes, using the exchange, using the comparison, you will see a drastic change in the case of quick sort. It will be almost half what you will do in the bubble sort. It will be almost less than, a little bit more than half what we do in the insertion sort. Bubble sort takes long time as compared to insertion. Insertion will take more time than the quick sort. And quick is maybe the fastest algorithm in amongst these 3. And this is anyway very fastest algorithm, provided the data is random. And here also it does not need a sorted data. If the data is random, it is even working very, it works very well. Okay. So this is one of the algorithms if you can do this. You see now here, x is equal to AR, and what is R? This is what we need to define. I is equal to P minus 1, J is equal to P to N R minus 1, and then goes like this, and this is one partition is started here. This is a one partition. You need to run this routine twice, then that will give you results. This is for one partition, and then you pass on here another partition. So if you do two partitions, like here we have the quick sort, instead of the quick sort, these are the partition here. So how you call this routine? If you combine these two, it will give you almost a kind of program, but you need to convert it to. We hope we can work on this on the lab as well, okay? This is the discussion. Here is this is the worst case analysis. Binary search we have discussed many times, so you can go back to those notes where we discussed recursions. Binary search, how much time it takes, and what is a linear search, and so on. If you remember this, we have discussed a lot. So with this, I think I will stop that. This we have finished with the algorithms part.